So that was one of the things that characterized publishing at the time. Another was that publishing, as I said, was by and large located inside the walled city and in Daryaganj. Today it is very, very different. Publishing houses have spread far beyond the old city and far beyond Delhi itself. So people are no longer located only in Delhi. They have moved out. They are no longer located only in Daryaganj. They have moved out in different places. And publishing services, which were then located in and around that area, because of the technological changes in publishing, they have also dispersed across the country so that you can be a publisher based in, say, Mumbai, and you can be actually working with somebody based in Bangalore or based in Pune or somewhere else. And this is all because of the rise of computers. Now, I started my publishing house, Kali, in 1984. But my journey into that began almost at the same time as my entry into the world of publishing. Because by the mid-70s, I was very deeply involved in the growing women's movement in India, in which I had become involved in my college years. And we were fighting for a whole range of women's issues, which were very close to us. These were the issues we understood. You know, safe buses in Delhi to get women from their homes to college and back, better hostel conditions for women, safe environment in the university, and so on. These were the things that preoccupied us at the time, and these were the sort of things we were fighting for. As we became more and more politically aware and more aware of women's issues, I began to ask myself the question, why was it that the books that I was engaged in publishing and the books that I saw around me all the time had little or nothing to do with the sorts of issues that had become issues for us, that preoccupied us? Why was it, for example, that those of us engaged in the battle against dowry had no knowledge or no understanding of what this phenomenon was, how it had transformed itself into the monster that it had become? Was it only a middle class phenomenon? Was it only something that applied to Hindus? Was it only urban? You know, what were its shape, dimension? What was its roots? Where did it come from? What was its political economy? How would we find this out? We would find this out if we had some knowledge. And there was nothing around at all. You could more or less count the number of books that were published by and about women on the fingers of one or two hands. And so I began to be very concerned about this, because there we were out in the streets demonstrating, but we were working almost blind. I began to ask my bosses, who were really nice men, you know, why aren't we doing books by women? And the answer I always got was, but, you know, women, what do they write? Women's issues, who'll take them seriously? Will anyone read? Now, every survey done anywhere in the world tells you that the majority of readers are women. But men can question the fact of women's reading in the face of all this information with an authority that makes it seem as if they're right. So I got this question all the time. Will women read? Do they read? Etc. So in the end, I was young, foolhardy, passionate about what I believed in, and I thought, okay, if they're not going to do it, I'll do it myself. I also remember that when I joined Oxford University Press, as I said, I was 21, I didn't know, but my father at the time came and met my bosses on the sly, he didn't tell me, and he read them the Riot Act, and he said to them, my daughter's joining your company. If you, any of you or any of your employees ever misbehaves with her, mere se bura koi nahi hoga, you know, that filmy dialogue type of thing. And they promised him that they would all behave well, and to their eternal credit, they did. I don't know what the situation is like today. But my boss at the time, when he appointed me, he said to me that we are very reluctant to appoint women in executive positions because, you know, women, they go away and get married. So it made it sound like it's a crime, and I felt immediately guilty, and I immediately reassured him and said, listen, I won't get married for 5 years. So now 40 years later, I'm still not married, and he is now in his, what, 85 or 86, and every now and again he rings me up and says, Urboshi, why don't you get married, you know, this. So we have this nice sort of thing. So anyway, so I took a decision that I would do it myself. But you know, you might decide something, it doesn't happen that easily, because really speaking, you think, yeah, I'll do this, but how do you start? Where do you go? What do? Where do you find the money? So I kept putting off the decision. And by this time, I had left my publishing job and taken up a teaching job, because I felt that publishing 9 to 5, and actually often turned into 9 to 10, did not give me any time for the activism that I wanted to be involved in. So I took up a teaching job, and I was basically teaching publishing in a course which had no relevance to publishing or anything, but I was doing it. And Delhi University that time was pretty flexible, so I could have a lot of free time, there were summer holidays, etc. Now, in the course of teaching, I got a scholarship. I got a scholarship to go, of all places, to Hawaii to study communications. Now, you're a student of communication here, so you'll know this. Study communications. And you know, when you're, what, I think I was 30, when you're in your 30s, you get offered a scholarship to go to Hawaii, you don't actually say no. So I said yes. I said yes, and I thought, okay, I'll do the publishing later. And I set off for Hawaii, planning to stop in England on the way for a month to spend time with some friends. And in England, I visited a publishing house, which you will know, called Z Books, which had recently started up and which was a publishing house, a cooperative of politically committed people who were doing publishing of books on what was then called the Third World. I went and talked to them. And the editor over there said to me, why are you going to Hawaii if you want to do your own publishing house? And I said, well, you know, I've got this fellowship. It's a Fulbright scholarship. So it had quite a lot of money attached to it. So he said, listen, can you swim? I said, no. He said, can you surf? I said, no. He said, then why are you going to Hawaii? There's no point. You know, the only point of going to Hawaii is that, stay here. And he made me an offer which was impossible to refuse. He said, stay here, work with us. We need somebody to set up a list of books on women. Do that, go home, set up your publishing house. And I immediately abandoned all plans to go to Hawaii. I felt quite guilty because obviously I had done somebody out of a fellowship, but then they said they had a waiting list and they would pass it on. And I stayed in England and I worked with this publisher called Z Books. And at the end of 2 years, I came back to set up Kali, the women's publishing house, that along with Ritu Menon, who used to be then with Vikas, and who got to hear that I was planning to do this, and who wrote to me and said, shall we do it together? And we did. Now, we set up Kali. For us, it was something that grew very much out of the women's movement. And we began to publish books. We did things that women do. We had no money. Both of us had given up our jobs. We set ourselves up in Ritu's garage, which her architect husband did up, and put two tables and chairs, and we sat down there and we started to look for books to do. What we did was we basically hawked our skills, because we had by that time X number of years of experience in publishing, in editorial production skills and so on. So we went to people and said, listen, you've got a book to publish, we'll do it for you and we'll charge you so much. And what we would do was, for each job that we took on, we would include in that money to publish one book. And so in that way, we managed to publish 3 or 4 books. Then we went to a funding organization and said to them, give us a grant to publish 2 books. They gave us 1.5 lakh. Seems like peanuts, but at that time it seemed like a fortune. And we published 2 other books. And in this way, we sort of managed to move on ahead. Interestingly, we didn't face any real major opposition, but we faced deep skepticism, which can be a very major obstacle in itself. The skepticism was, can women run a business? Do women read? Will you be able to survive? Who will read your books? And so on. This was the skepticism that we faced from the general population, if you like. But at the same time, we had this huge amount of really solid support from the women's movement. Activists who believed in the project of Kali, as Shilpa just mentioned to you, would go into bookshops, would go to libraries and say, when is the next Kali book coming out? And for us, that was something that really wonderfully kept us going. And we, because of my having worked with Zed Books for 2 years, I had made a lot of contacts abroad, and we were able to sell our books there and earn some money. And of course, we didn't pay ourselves anything. So we carried on working in that fashion. The most difficult thing, actually, was to deal with women's own lack of confidence in their ability to write and in their ability or their sense that they had nothing serious to say. So to work with women, to instill in them the confidence that what they were thinking, the questions they were raising, were worthy of being said, that was the most difficult thing of all. But there were some wonderful moments in that. And one of them was that one day we got visited by a group of about 15 or 20 women. Four of them were urban activists. The rest of them were women from Rajasthan who had been part of a program called the Women's Development Program, in the course of which they had held workshops on health, and they had developed a book called Sharir Ki Jankari, which was about women's bodies. And they brought us this book and told us its story. And it was the most wonderful story, and it was the kind of book that every feminist publisher dreams about. You know, for us as feminist publishers, the fact that we were publishing books by women, yes, that was important, but we were always aware of our limitations. We were publishing in English, a little bit in Hindi. Obviously, that means you're disconnected from a whole range of experiences that form part of women's activism in our country. We were based in Delhi, and obviously we couldn't reach out everywhere. And books in themselves, wonderful though they are a very limited medium, because they are limited to those who can read, even though their influence might well spread beyond those who can read.